It says, why do I feel this good sober? You gotta understand what she said. What she? Go ahead.
No, I was just telling her it's a very deep song. It's a spiritual song.
Tell us what.
Because I'm safe up high. Nothing can touch me. Come on. And I'm sober. This party's over.
I'm messed up on all the stuff in the world.
Mm-hmm.
Come on.
Well, see, here's what happened. The hook says, I'm safe up high. Nothing can touch me. But why do I feel this party's over? No pain. Inside, you're my protection. How do I feel this good sober? Come on, run it back. Here we go. Nah, just a hook. We just want to vibe for a second. I can hear it just vibing it. Come on. Just vibing.
That's not the way I want my swing.
Come on, here we go. Y'all ready? Yo.
I'm safe up high.
Pastor, I look like you crazy. Guess what? Nobody's going to understand it until you understand the book of Psalms, chapter 27, verse 5 and 6. I just wanted to articulate that. Y'all will get in like 5 years. Just watch. In like 5 years, you're like, yo, man, he was right. I see where he was going with it. Just watch. In 5 years, just watch what happens. What I'm saying is, I believe that the way the word of God is going to sync with the people's heart and the people's spirit, I believe that this is going to be a way that you'll be able to reach people instantly. But the minute you say something that catches somebody's mind, boom, you've got a song playing. Boom, you got music playing. You've got chords. You got words on the screen. And then people will begin to get into the vibe of it. Just watch. About 5 years from now, y'all going to be like, yo, Pastor Mike over in China, tripping. But I get it now. What made David so great, Jamila. What David made so great was David knew how to write the words to the song that would articulate his pain. And 4,000 years later, we're still reading words of songs that were written thousands of years before, hundreds of years ago. I mean, this is amazing. So when you begin to write the song that you wrote before, that awesome, wonderful song, can you hear me? Do you see me? Can you feel my pain? That's what David was saying. Amen. We just want to test it out. You got something else? You sure? Yeah, you can rock it out. Rock it out before we get there. Play a little bit. Just listen to it, y'all. You're getting the
silence. Quiet scares me because it screams the truth. Please don't tell me that we had that conversation. I won't remember, save your breath because I feel you.
Come on, Jesus. Speak to us in the song, God. Speak to us in words and in deeds and in actions. Well, y'all should know by now. Ready?
I'm safe up high. Nothing can touch me. Why do I feel this body's over?
Right now. Come on, here we go. One more.
I'm safe up high. Nothing can touch me. Why do I feel this kind of love?
Come on. It's over, y'all.
No pain inside. No more protection.
You're my perfection. If that's not God, I don't know what is. Just wait, we're doing on one of these Sundays. Maybe when we get back from Florida, let me walk you through it. But I just wanted to impart that to your spirit. Amen. Thank you, Lord. Dez in the building, all hats off. Dez, it was such a wonderful blessing to hear. You look just like you did. Sit right, don't move. Just like that. You look just like Yaz. That's exactly how she looks. Same movements, everything. That's amazing. But it was so wonderful to hear you articulate what you were saying today about how the enemy will begin to remind you of your failures, remind you of who you used to be. Because you know you're not that anymore, but the enemy will try to convince you of who you used to be in the name of Jesus. That's not you anymore. The Bible says, it says, forgetting those things that are behind and looking towards the things that are forward or ahead of you or above you or in front of you. And we have to begin to know that. We have to begin to understand that. This is the last week, maybe the last week, I believe it's the last week of the tithing segment of our learning process. It's been fun. We've gone through New Testament, Old Testament. We haven't once yet hit Malachi, Regina, right? The blood, right? How can you teach tithing and never talk about Malachi? Well, we did it. We never talked about it. But we talked more about the heart issue. We talked about sacrificing yourself. We talked about presenting yourself before God. We talked about being able to be used by God. We talked about all hats off the live stream. I see them sending us messages. Welcome live stream viewers and visitors and the like. But when we talked about tithing, we went all around the board. We went through Genesis chapter 15, and we talked about Lot and Abram. We went through Exodus chapter 12, which we're going to end up in tonight. We went through Matthew chapter 1. We went through Mark. We went through a bunch of scriptures. But I'm hoping that as you're learning and as God is talking to you, and sometimes, generally, this might be a little foreign, but they're all on YouTube. You can go check it out if you want. But tithing or presenting your substance to God is a heart issue. It's a heart matter. It's an issue of God cleansing your heart and God being able to use you in all the things that He gave you. There's seven reasons why prayers do get answered or don't get answered, whichever way you choose to look at it. But let's take a look at the seven reasons that God gave me on why prayers do or do not get answered. Seven reasons why prayers do or do not get answered. If you do these things, you can guarantee a prayer is going to come forth. If you do these things, if you live a certain way, you can know that God is going to answer all of your prayers. If you can present yourself before God in this manner, there's seven key steps to any prayer getting answered. Now, doesn't mean all seven have to happen, but these seven components, I believe, are in any prayer getting answered. Anybody want to walk through them real quick? And the reason I'm saying this before we get into our last tithing scripture, or our last tithing ceremony, or segment, whatever you choose to call it, is I believe that one of the things that people have a hard time doing when it comes to God is staying committed with God. It's very hard to be committed because it means I not only have to sacrifice my mind, not my brain, but my mind, I have to sacrifice my flesh, and I also have to sacrifice my substance. there's three things that I have to present before God, and it's hard being consistent in presenting all those things to God consistently. It's just very difficult for a lot of people. It's not really that difficult, but it can be that way in the flesh. You do live in this world. There's a lot of things pulling at you. There's a lot of, you know, somebody put on social media, I think it was Shelly Shell, and she said, I wish social media could go away for a year so people could just be who they are. Well, I believe that many people get lost in the cares of this world. We just get lost. We get lost in new clothes. If we don't have new clothes, we don't feel worthy. If we do have new clothes, we feel more than worthy. You know, if we have our hair done, we feel great. If we don't have our hair done, we got a hat on and we're ducking in the supermarket. Like, can't nobody see us, right? Come on now. I know some of y'all know what I'm talking about. It's important that you understand that God doesn't care about the cares of this world. And the more we bring the cares of this world up, the further and further away we drift away from God. You might be away from God this much, but that much is a lot. Like, you may move just a tiny, tiny bit. You ever be this much away from God and feel like you'll never get back? You feel like you'll never get back? You might be that close or that far away, and you can feel like you'll never get back. I've been there before. I woke up one day, and I was like, I'm gone. I was still a husband, married to Pastor Miriam. I was still elder at the church. I was still working. I was still everything, but I was this far away. I knew it. I knew I was this far away, and that far away might as well be in Egypt. I might as well have been in California. I might as well have been in Alaska somewhere. That's how far away I was. That little tiny bit. The reality was, it didn't take me long to get back, but that was a lot. Just that much. That level of commitment could be that minute, but it can make the world a difference. So, several reasons why prayers do or do not get answered. I'm just going to go through these very quickly because I want to show you something about the last segment of tithing and how when you begin to sacrifice your substance, and your substance is yourself, your natural things that God has given you, your mind, your heart, all those different things are part of your substance. Seven reasons why prayers do get answered if you want to look at it from a glass half full standpoint. Amen. All hats off. First of all, you have to know that your prayers are being heard. Step number one, you have to know that God has heard your prayers. You have to know that God is listening to you. When God speaks to you, and you speak to him, he's listening. It's an open dialogue. Step number one, to know that a prayer is getting answered, you've got to be confident to know that your Father who art in heaven hears you. Step number one. Step number two, you've got to know that there's always going to be some form of prophetic revelation that you should be looking out for. You should always, every time you're riding down the street in your car, John Dillon with a J, you got to look at the billboards and see what God is saying. God's always showing you something in some kind of billboard. He's always showing you something in some conversation that you're having with somebody. God will show you something in a bottle. God will show you something in a bag. God will show you something on a car. He'll show you something. But there's always some sort of prophetic revelation that you must seek after. This is how you know a prayer is going to get answered. God, show me something that I can't see with my natural eye. Step number three, you must celebrate it before you see it. Now, this is in no order, but you must celebrate the thing that you're asking God for. Start celebrating it. Start turning up before you actually see it. So if you apply for a job, you might as well start dancing. Like, yo, I just got this new job. It's about to go down. I'm about to get my money. Kanye had a song. He said, whoa, wait till I get my money. He said, you can't tell me nothing. Wait till I get my money right. Now, he didn't have the money at the time he was singing the song, but he was saying it in advance. He was celebrating it before he saw it. Then there's another song that says, I got a Lincoln Continental and a sunroof Cadillac, right? They didn't have that when they wrote the song, but they were speaking it in advance so that way when they got it, they were able to appreciate it. So step number three is you've got to begin to celebrate the thing that you're praying for before you see it. So that means you've got to, you know, the televangelist might call it name it and claim it. But in all reality, you've got to celebrate it before you see it. Step number three. So if you're following along or writing this down, step number one, you got to know that God has heard you. Step number two, seek out prophetic revelation. God, show me something that I can't see. Step number three, you must celebrate it before you see it. Step number four, this is a big one. You must be a caretaker of what God is going to give you. You must be a caretaker. What does a caretaker mean? It means that when I get this fine china, you ever notice you go to grandma's house and grandma's got this fine china and she only brings it out for special occasions. It's not on the table every day. You know, I know some of y'all got old school parents where they used to have the plastic on their couch and you couldn't, you know what I mean? the plastic never came off the couch. It just never came off the couch. That's just the way it is. So the plastic never came off the couch. There were certain rooms in your mom's house, or your grandma's house that you couldn't go in. You couldn't sit in. No, baby, you can't sit there. I'm sorry. You know. So you have to be a caretaker of it. You've got to make sure that you're going to make a provision to value what God is getting ready to give you. Now, this is one of the reasons why many marriages end in divorce. I don't know why we end up talking about this all the time, but one of the reasons is we pray for a spouse and we fail to take care of it. I said it. So let me take that back. We fail to take care of the relationship or them. The person we pray for is usually the last person we take care of. Okay, let me give you an example. If somebody asks you, you say to somebody, hey, what do you want for Christmas, right? Everybody gets their little list, and the song says he's making a list, he's checking it twice, he's going to find out who's naughty or nice, right? So everything that you want for Christmas is on the list. If you write down a list and you say, this is what I want, the fact of the matter is when you're a caretaker of the word or you're a caretaker in your relationship, whatever the person tells you, it's your job to listen and to now perform those things. If you don't, I'll leave it at that. Number five, you have to offer it back to God. Whatever you're praying for, you must first offer it back to God. So if you say, God, I'm unemployed, I want this job, the first thing you should say is, God, when you give me this job, it's yours. My finances, yours. My substance, yours. My time, yours. This job will not take away from our relationship. God doesn't give you anything that he wants you to have for it to take away from your relationship with him. That's not God. So sometimes people say, well, I got a new job and my job, you know, keeps me away from God. That ain't God. That might be the wrong job. God might not have sent you there, or maybe you're doing it wrong. You know, Jay-Z said, I made it a hotline, you made it a hot, I mean, you, yeah, you made it. You had a hotline, I made it a hot song, whatever. He said, but you're doing it wrong. If there's something pulling you away from God, that's not God. You've got to know that. So you've got to offer whatever you're asking God for. Now, some people are tuning in and writing it down. Cool, good job. Hopefully you'll apply this every day. Just think about it. Okay, these are my seven steps to get a prayer answer. I've offered it back to God. God, if you give me this husband, Pastor Merriam, I'm going to present my husband, Mike Brown, back to you. He's yours. He doesn't belong to me anymore. He's yours. As quick as you get it, give it back to God. As quick as you get it, give it back to God. Amen? Okay, let me give an example. God gives you a brand new car. God, help me use this car for your glory. Help me use this vehicle to get the people of God around. Help me use it to bless somebody. I'm presenting it or offering it back up to God. Step number six, never doubt. Step number six, do not doubt. If God said it, what's that song? God will do what he said. I can't sing, General. You got to come up here and help me sing that song. What's that song? God will do what he said he can do, and he'll stand by his word. Well, the reality of it is God will do exactly what he said he can do. So you've got to know that there can never be any doubt that will enter your mind. Remember we said on Sunday, premature evacuation. Premature evacuation. I knew I was going to get one laugh. See, that's how you know your ears, when you hear certain sounds, you automatically assume that's the way your mind works. Des did a good job. She had her head down the whole time. I was watching you, Des. So premature evacuation. You were here on Sunday, Des? No, that's right. Premature evacuation, meaning God has you in a position of faith. Look at this. Des, you said last week, you said, I like this little circle. Right? Remember you said that a couple weeks ago? And premature evacuation is when it gets hot, I get out the kitchen. God says, I'm going to make you comfortable in the heat. we say, I gotta get out the kitchen. Comfortable in the heat, I've gotta get out the kitchen. These are 7 steps to make sure that all of your prayers get answered. Step number 7. So step number 6, let's state it real quick. Stay focused, never doubt. Never, ever, ever doubt. If God says it, now the thing is, we don't know when God said it. That's usually our problem. We don't know if God says, hey, that's your job over there. That's your man, that's your wife, that's your decision, that's your school, that's your scholarship. We don't know that God said it because most of the time we're not really in tune with God. The only way you get in tune with God is to be in tune with his word. It's a must. Step number 7. Step number 7 is you must honor the vessel by which God delivers the message to you in. Honor the vessel. So God says, if God sends the R to come and give you a word, and all you've done all the 6 steps, and the R is the one that comes and says, yo, your house is dirty, you need to clean up. Don't kick her out. Listen, that's step number 7. Hold on, wait a minute. God sent her. God's going to always send a carrier of the word to bring it to you. He's always going to send a carrier of the word. So you got to pray, God, who's the person that's linked to me? Who am I linked to? What is my blessing that I've been praying for linked to? Why do you think this is one of the most important steps of it? Your blessing is linked to someone because you can't be so mean and nasty and so standoffish to everybody. Your blessing is linked to someone. This is why many ministries fail, because usually in ministry, husband and wives are not walking together in ministry, so therefore the wife is usually the one with all the word of God, the husband's the one with that's making the money, and there's a power struggle in the house. They're like playing tug of war. You know, it's a power struggle. It's like right out of corporate America. We've got to honor the vessel by which God is choosing to relinquish the blessing to us in. And most times we'll honor everybody else. But the word of God says a prophet gets honor everywhere except where? In his own home. That means in your own home, you're going to be the most disrespected person. Everybody else will be loved, but you'll be probably the one that's disrespected. Everybody else out there in the world loves you. Everybody else in the world values your product. Everybody else in the world loves your spirit. But in the house, you're probably going to be the one that's the most attacked. Everybody else sees you walking in signs, wonders, and miracles, sees where God's taking you. In your house, you're just a nagging wife. In your house, you're just the overbearing husband. In your house, you're just, stop being my dad. In your house, you're just a lazy, you know. 7 steps to making sure a prayer gets answered. Step number 1, your prayers are being heard. Step number 2, the power of the prophetic revelation. Step number 3, you got to celebrate it before you see it. Step number 4, you got to be a caretaker. Make sure you take care of what God's getting ready to give you. Step number 5, make sure you got to offer it back up to God. Step number 6, never doubt. Step number 7 is you must honor the vessel. The vessel must have honor with it. Amen? Exodus chapter 12. Exodus chapter 12. Again, for those on live stream, we are in Exodus chapter 12, and I'll tell you the verse in just a second. Faithy's got her headphones on. She can't type the verse up. Look at her. Look. I love it. Amen. How y'all feeling tonight? Y'all good? Feels like, are y'all like weighed down? Y'all tired? It's been a long day. It's hump day? Yes. I got you. I understand. Well, the good news is tonight we got a hump day word tonight. Today's going to be a hump day word. We're going to do the hump tonight. Exodus chapter 12, which is the 2nd book in the Bible. Exodus chapter 12, and we're talking about the last segment of tithing. And this is going to be the ultimate cat to tithing. We could probably go a whole different way with this scripture, but we're going to talk about this, and we're going to kind of close it out on tithing today. Amen. And we're going to read out of the chapter 28. We're going to read out of Exodus chapter 12, verse 28. And I'm going to pull up the NIV version. This might be my last time reading the NIV version ever, but I'm going to read it tonight. Exodus chapter 12. We're going to start at verse 28. Hey, man. How you doing, man of God? Good to see you, son. It's amazing because he had those wrestling toys, and those toys represent greatness. When you let me see one of those toys, if you don't mind. Can I see one? One of the most amazing things about these toys is when you look at this guy. If this isn't Magic Mike, y'all slow down. But when you see these guys, if you look at their physique, male or female, when you get these dolls, what's usually the characteristic of them? Strong, muscular, not an ounce of fat on them. They look like they're in perfect physique. Perfect physique. Anytime you buy a doll, let me see the other one. That's cool. It's all good. But look at the muscles. Again, y'all, not Magic Mike. Look at that. Six-pack, muscles, toned up, everything, right? When God articulated you and when God made you in his image, God made you the same exact way. God made you perfect no matter what you look like, no matter what you weigh on the scale, no matter whether your hair is done or not. God has made you perfect. And when you honor God's word, when you honor God's word with your substance, you'll look just like that in the spirit to God. Perfect physique. Muscular, six-pack. I know some of y'all talked to Pastor Mary the other day, and she was like, yeah, man, she was sick the other day. And she was like, man, I've been sick. And her stomach was hurting, going to the doctor. But guess what? She stepped on the scale, was 5 pounds lighter. And she said, oh, man, I'm ready. I'm getting ready for Florida. Sometimes God will send an illness to you or infirmity to you just to get you to feel better. She was like, man, I lost weight. I've been trying to lose weight, right? She's like, I got the microphone. What I'm saying is all things work together for good for them that love the Lord and are called to his purpose. God will use the infirmity that you prayed to get out of your body to show you where he's taking you. That's all I'm saying to you. God will use whatever situation you're going through to help you get to where you need to go. That's why you can have somebody like Oprah who can go through what she went through in her childhood and be one of the most famous people in the world. God will use what you've been through. God will use where you were to get you where you got to go. Remember we had the sermon, it ain't where you're from, is what? Where you at? God's trying to show you where you're going. He's not worried about your beginning. He already told you the latter days are going to be better than your former days. Stop worrying about that. God, just use this infirmity to help me get in shape, to lose weight, so I can really be who you called me to be. Most of us would never eat healthy if it was not for illness or infirmity. We wouldn't be trying to eat healthy. We'd be like, man, come on, McDonald's, KFC, Mickey, Chick-fil-A, all these other stuff. Exodus chapter 12. But when God sees you as a perfect individual. And so what I want to show you is the last part about tithing is about your heart and your obedience. So when you become obedient to God, Second Corinthians. Second Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3. Actually, I'm going to switch gears for a second. I'm going to go back to Exodus. I promise, Des. I promise you. But I want to show you this very quick thing because I believe this is important to the teaching. I believe it's important. I know it's important. Not I believe. I know it's important to the teaching. I know it's important for you to understand. Second Corinthians chapter 10. Where is Corinthians chapter 10? I'll read it to you. Don't worry about it. It's all good. It says, this is verse 3. Though we walk in the flesh, we don't war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God, pulling down strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every thought to the obedience of Christ. Here's the key I wanted to show you. Having a readiness or a willingness or an ability to revenge all disobedience when your obedience is fulfilled or has been accomplished. The Bible says that when you walk in obedience, you now have greater natural ability from a supernatural realm. Before I read Exodus, I want to show you this. He's talking about the weapons that we can fight with coming from a spiritual place. And when you come from a spiritual place, they have a greater power. When your weapons are from a spiritual place, they have a greater power. So if you go to say somebody says to you, Des, 3 o'clock. 3 o'clock, right? If you just stood there and didn't move, and at 3 o'clock you stay right in the classroom, not because you're scared, but you stay in the classroom and you just prayed and prayed and prayed, I'm telling you, enemies will begin to fall outside the parking lot of the school. The people that wanted to fight you will probably run home. If they knew you just stood there and prayed in the name of Jesus and lifted up God's name in the face of a fight, they run. There'd be no devil in hell that would. And if that devil did dare to try to touch you, God would give you such supernatural power that you would. The Bible says one can chase down 1,000. How? They're fighting with weapons that are supernatural. You know what I'm talking to. You tell them that when they get into an altercation, stand there and pray in the name of Jesus, and you watch what will happen. I know it sounds funny. I know it sounds crazy. But I'm telling you, if you stood there when they were ready to shut your wood off and say, in the name of Jesus, Father, I pray for favor, grace, and mercy. That woman man would be running from your crib like, yo, I'm getting out of here. Because he swear lightning was getting ready to drop down. Not saying you don't have to pay your bill. Go ahead and pay your bill. Take care of what you need to take care of. But if you would activate the power of God in the middle of a crisis, it will be amazing. Amen. If you would activate the power of God in the middle of a crisis, it will be amazing. That's hard to do because you've got to know you can either trust your fist or the Father. Your fist or the Father. Which one am I going to trust? In the midst of somebody saying they're going to knock me out at 3 o'clock, am I going to trust him in the power of my fist or the power of the Father? I'm telling you, if you would trust the power of the Father, your enemies will begin to run away from you. The Bible clearly says it. It says the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but they're mighty through God, pulling down strongholds, casting down imaginations, and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, and being ready to avenge all disobedience, or having the ability or the power to overcome the obstacle because you rest in a supernatural realm. Now turn to Exodus chapter 12. Amen. Here we go. In the middle of a crisis, that's where Christ is. In the middle of a crisis, that's where Christ is. He's not outside the crisis. He's in the middle of it with you. If you're in the tornado swirling around, God's standing right there with you saying, I got this. Let me handle this. In the middle of a crisis, that's where Christ is. See, we don't trust it, we don't believe it, because we've never tried it. We've never tried it. Most of us have never really tried Christ in the middle of a crisis.
That's not true.
I'm saying, in the majority of the times in your life, if you look at all the crises you've had, how many times have you stood there and said, Father, in the name of Jesus, fix this situation? How many times? Versus, now listen, I'm not talking about all the major crises. When somebody calls you a name, when somebody says you look ugly, when something happens at the job, when you get a flat tire, when you get a car accident, when you can't find your barrettes for your hair, when you can't find your lip gloss, when you can't find deodorant, those are all major crises that people face every day. Most of the crises that people face aren't major life-threatening crises, but it's that one last straw that's going to break the what? Camel's back. That's the crisis. See, immediately everybody probably thought of, no, I'm telling you, when my son was getting ready to get ran over by a car, I screamed on Jesus and the car jumped in the air, right?
All the time, but like what you said, it's true, because I remember when, even when we had a situation with the stony son at the church, and we were praying for him, and as a mom, she wasn't praying. She was like, wake up. Mm-hmm. Like, she didn't call no Jesus or something. She was trying to like, get her son. So, that was
it. Amen. Were you there, Des? Were you there that day in the old building? You heard about it, though. Okay. We're in the old building. You were there in the Colex, right? You weren't there that day? You heard about it. There's no way you could not have heard about it. So we're there in the middle of service, right? We're praying. All we hear is, I got it on my phone. All you hear is, his lifeless body hit the ground. A little boy, 6-year-old boy. His body hits the ground. When his body hits the ground, Everybody, all you hear on the phone recorder or live stream was, oh my God, he passed out, oh my God. And all you hear is chaos. People running around crying, screaming, da 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 da. But you hear a couple people praying, Father, in the name of Jesus, we're praying. So we rip his shirt off, we're breathing life into him, no CPR, no nothing. Just praying, prayer, 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 prayer. And then at a certain point, his eyes go in the back of his head, he's motionless, lifeless, everything. And in the whole room, you hear silence. It's nobody doing anything except me, Pastor Merriman, maybe one more, it might have been Regina, and I think maybe Mama Hinton, voice you could hear on the audio tape. Everybody else in the room realized this boy just died. And all that was a crisis. But sometimes in the middle of a crisis, you have so much fear, you're just immobilized. It ain't that you don't have faith, but you're just like this. What do I do? But in the middle of a crisis, that's where Christ is. Not only for the big ones, but for the small ones too. When you're late for work, how many times do you say, Father, in Jesus' name, move these cars out of my way. I've got to get to my destination on time. In the middle of a crisis, that's where Christ is. And our natural instinct is to lean on our own understanding. Call the police. Do CPR. Pump his chest. Do the Heimlich maneuver. How many times have you saw somebody choking and you just stood there? Chicken, come out of her throat in the name of Jesus. It sounds ludicrous, right? Everybody even laugh like, yo, man, come on, man. But guess what? What if you did it? What if you just had the power and the ability to say, in the name of Jesus, I demand my finances to turn around now. Exodus chapter 12. In the middle of a crisis, that's where Christ is. And remember, most crises that we face on a daily basis aren't life-threatening. It's just you can't take anymore. You can't take one more disappointment. You can't take one more Stacy in the building. Oh, hats off. You can't take one more disappointment. You can't take one more letdown. You can't take one more level of rejection. You can't take one more person rolling their eyes at you. You can't take one more person sucking their teeth. You can't take one more person gossiping about you, murmuring about you. That one more thing is going to break your back. God gave me this one day, I'm not going to go into it because it's a whole different sermon, but God gave me this message one day. He didn't give me a scripture or anything, but he gave me this one thing. He said, you are not the camel, you're the straw. You're not the camel, you're the straw. They say, it's the straw that broke the camel's back. You're not the camel. You're the straw breaking the enemy's back. You are not the camel. That one little piece of straw is not going to break your back. You are the straw. You are the thing that when you touch something, that's when it breaks. When I lay hands on my wife in Jesus' name, I got to believe that I've got the power to heal anything that's in her body, or else I might as well not touch her. You are the straw. Whole different sermon. But God says where there's a crisis, that's where Christ is. And the reality of it is most people only call on God when they really want man. Most people call on God because they know that God's going to send man to help them. Where there's a crisis, that's where Christ is. He's your all-sufficiency. What do I mean by that? We'll call, say, Father, in the name of Jesus, Lord, I need food in my refrigerator. And we're waiting for somebody to come and give us $100. Or somebody come bring food over. That's not fully relying on God. Because you're still expecting man to do something. Why can't God just make you not hungry anymore? That might be God's way of answering that prayer. You just won't be hungry. I'm going to take the taste of food out of your mouth. Amen? See, we don't like that because we want chicken and grits and fish and all that good stuff. We don't like that. We don't like if we ask God and God gives us the answer, we don't like it because we might not like his answer. But in the middle of crisis, that's what Christ is. Okay, God, I have nothing to eat in my refrigerator. I can either pray for food or pray that you would keep me in this state because I don't know how long you want me here. We don't like that. because we're still expecting man to come over and buy us stuff. It's not right. Usually in my job, a lot of times, right, I work in a crazy job, but I was talking to somebody the other day, and they were like, Mike, man, I'm going to lose my house. And I was like, no, you're not. And he's like, why are you saying that? I was like, because I know God. And they're like, what are you talking about? Like, what do you mean you know God? You know God what? I'm like, because I know God. And they were like, well, what does that mean? I know God. They said, but what does that have to do with the mortgage company? God can tell the mortgage company what to do. What are you talking about? I know God. And they were arguing me down about why I should have a natural reason to help them solve the problem. I was like, well, if you don't know God, then all right, I can transfer you to another client. No, it's cool. But why can't that just be your answer? I'm not stressing about my problems because I have a relationship with God. I no longer have to stress anymore. He said, lay aside every sin and weight that so easily besets you. I'm not limited to this world. Exodus chapter 12. This is the last version of tithing or sacrificing or presenting what you have to God. Remember, where there's a crisis, that's where Christ is. Look at verse 28, and then we'll get you out of here. We'll kind of wrap it on up. It says, and the children of Israel went away and did as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron, so did they. Let me read it one more time, because I think I might have read it wrong. And the children of Israel went away and did as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron, so did they. So the first step that we read in 2 Corinthians chapter 10 and 3, thank you, Des, was the power of obedience. Right here, the reason why I started in verse 28, we're going to build up to show you the power of obedience. And many of us, we don't want to be obedient to anyone. We feel like, I'm grown. I'm grown. I make my own money. I'm this. I'm independent. Can't nobody tell me what to do. You know what I mean? We want to always feel like we're calling the shots. Big baller, shot caller, I got it. But the true power of deliverance is in obedience. The greatest power is in obedience. He said, and the children of Israel went away and did as the Lord had commanded Moses and Aaron, so they did, or so did they. And it came to pass, we're in Exodus chapter 12, Stacy Scott. Exodus chapter 12, amen. It's so wonderful to see you, Stacy. And Stacy's got such a sweet spirit. Ever since I've known her, she got a wonderful, sweet spirit. And it came to pass that at midnight, the Lord smote all of the firstborn in the land of Egypt. From the firstborn of the Pharaoh that sat on his throne unto the firstborn of the captive that was in his dungeon and all of the firstborn cattle. What God is showing you right here is the power of obedience that every one of your enemies that's facing you on every level, whether it was the highest level, which is Pharaoh, whether it was Pharaoh's slaves, it said that they slay every one of the enemies. That's what happens when you walk in the power of obedience. The power of God, of you being obedient to God's word, is everything that's around you, you won't even be able to see what enemy God has destroyed around you. But it's not for you to see. You have to be confident to know. Remember, one of the reasons why prayers get answered, you got to know that God heard you. When you're obedient, you know that God hears you. When you're disobedient, it's impossible for God to hear you. Impossible. At that moment, it's impossible. He can't hear you. You're disobedient. Why would he hear you? Why would a loving, righteous God listen to a disobedient people? He won't do it. Doesn't mean he doesn't love you. He just won't hear you. You know what I mean? He's got his beats on. When I wear those beats, right, when I walk down the street, you know what I hear? Has anybody wear those beats that go all the way over your ear? What do you hear, Des? Say it again.
Nothing.
Say it again.
Nothing.
Right? The only thing you can hear when you wear those beats is the sound of your feet hitting the ground. That's it. If you don't have music on, you'll hear doom, doom, doom. You'll hear your bones shaking. Try it. When she's done, put the beats on and walk around the church. You'll hear the sound of your feet hitting the ground. It's the most amazing thing I've ever heard. No music, just wear the beats. Somebody got tap faith like, yo, can I get them beats? This is the power of obedience. Here we go. Now mind you, listen. When you talk about God, I'm going to present my finances, my time, whatever to you. The first thing what you're saying is, God, you're not doing it out of obligation to man. You're doing it out of obedience to God so that you can have dynamic power. That's the reward of your obedience. You're not doing it just to be obedient. Pastor said we got to do this, or pastor said we have to do that. No, that's the wrong reason to do anything. I'm nobody to anybody. Nobody. My daughter, when she made live stream Monday the other day, it's up to her to tithe. I can tell her and teach her, but hopefully her heart is right and she'll do it on her own. The power of obedience. And it came to pass at midnight that the Lord smote all the firstborn in the land of Egypt. From the firstborn of Pharaoh, that means the descendants of the king, to the firstborn of the slaves and all the animals. And Pharaoh rose up in the night, and he and all his servants and all the Egyptians, and there was a great cry in Egypt. For there was not a house where there was not one dead. What God is saying to you today is that when you walk in the power of God's obedience, there will not be one of your enemies that will not feel the wrath of God because of your obedience. Sickness in your body is an enemy to God. Lack and poverty, those are enemies to God. Fear, doubt, unbelief, those are enemies to God. Every one of your enemies, when you walk in obedience, they're subject to the power of God. Think of it like this, Nicole. Every enemy that you face is subject to your obedience to God. They're subject to God's power working through you because of your obedience. It said that they smoked, everything was dying around them. The only thing that was living was them. Get you, like, really just grab to think about it. So just imagine your enemy, the greatest enemy that you have. Pharaoh rose up at night, he and all his servants, everybody connected to him, all the Egyptians, and there was a great cry in Egypt. Now here's Egypt. Egypt is the slave master, and they're running from the slaves. It's deep, right? The slave masters are running from the slaves. It says there was not one house that was not at least one person dead there. Here we go. And he called for Moses and Aaron by night. Now mind you, this is Pharaoh. And he said, wake up, rise up, come forth from among your people, both you and the children of Israel, and go and serve the Lord as you have said. Now this is a very intricate scripture. And this is why I wanted to end the tithing with this one right here, to show you the power of the obedience, that all of your enemies will be subject to the power of God when you walk in faith. It says, and Pharaoh called Moses and Aaron in the middle of the night and said, come over here. It says, you and the children of Israel, go and serve the Lord as you have said. Now here's the thing. Pharaoh or your enemy knows what you have committed yourself to do for God. You write that down. Pharaoh, your enemy, knows what you have committed to do for God. The devil, the enemy, Satan, knows what you committed to God. Because remember, he's part of the conversation. So Satan says, okay, here we go. Pastor Miriam, you said if you got married, you would love till death do you part. You would choose to forgive. That's what you said. Do you still keep that commandment? That's what your enemy will say to you. Nicole, you said, if God gets you out of this jam one more time, Stacy, God, if you just do this thing, God, if you just pay my, if you just, whatever it is, whatever is on your list, your enemy knows this. See, most people always teach the exciting parts of the gospel. Read the little small parts. It says, he said in the word, Exodus chapter 12, verse 31, go and serve the Lord as you have said you would. Your enemy knows, John Miller, the commitment that you make to God. This isn't to condemn anybody. This is to let you know that you got to be careful. Anything that you say can and will be used against you in the court of law. You said it. You said I do. You said I'll tithe. You said I'll sacrifice. You said I love your church. You said you won't do it again. You said it. Nobody else said it. You said it. When God, when you had no job, right? When I had no job, God, I'm telling you, I promise you, God, if you just give me this job, making this money, give me this company car, I'll be faithful, and then God does it. But God, hold on, listen, what I really meant was, what I was trying to say to you was, you said it. It didn't say God said, do as you said. The enemy said, keep your word to God. If I don't throw my microphone across this room, you hear what I'm saying, Des? The enemy said this, not the people, not some pastor. Stand up, Aisha Brinkley, and do what you said to do. Keep your word to God. No, the enemy said that to you. So the enemy's looking at you like, you really love God? And you ain't doing what he said? Okay. Watch what happens to you. This is the enemy talking, not God, not the children of God, not Moses, not Aaron. This is Pharaoh talking. This is the slave master saying, boy, Toby, you said if you would get out of this thing, out of this slave ship, that you would serve God all your life. You better keep your word. This is the enemy saying this to you. How dare us be shown up by the enemy? Just think about it, Pastor Miriam. This is like Jezebel coming to you saying, I'm going to use, I can only talk to my wife. None of y'all better not talk to her like this. This is like Jezebel coming to you saying, if you don't love your husband, I will. It's the same thing. It's the same thing. Same thing. This is like a child molester coming up to you saying, if you don't take care of your child, keep your word. Whatever the craziest thing that you can imagine, whatever your arch enemy is, this is like the Joker coming up to you, Stacy. The Joker, you're Batman. And he's saying, look, you better keep your word. The arch enemy. I'm going to read this one more time. I'm going to close. The Bible says in the book of Job, the sons of God presented themselves, and here was the enemy right there with them. The Bible says Satan, the spirit of Satan, came right next to David and made David number all the people, and it cost 70,000 people their lives. The Bible says when Jesus, Pastor Man preached this so eloquently 3 weeks ago, go on live stream, check it out. In Luke chapter 4, Matthew chapter 4, right next to Jesus was right there Satan. Satan is in the middle of all of these conversations, and we always think Satan is always causing trouble. Sometimes Satan is looking at you like, why are you not doing what you said you would do for God? Satan saying this. Not, don't want to, yo, I'm leaving the church, the pastor said we got a tie. Satan told you that. He reminded you of what you said, not the pastor. Pastors do will love you. Satan's the one talking to you saying, you said you was going, and he's right. See, Satan doesn't love you when he tells you that, but he's still going to tell you the truth. He's going to just remind you of what you said. Pastor's going to love you. Oh, don't worry, baby. It's going to be okay. You know, pastor man going to hug you and say, I know you're going to get it together one day. We know we're just going to keep praying for you and keep loving on you. Satan's going to be like, yeah, all right, you better let that little heifer go and you better tell the pair. That's how Satan talks. We don't talk like that. But Satan, he'll call you all kind of names, but he'll still remind you of what you said. Pharaoh was in a position where he was like, look, I see where God's sending you. You guys are going to be a great people. You are the children of God. You are going to be great. You go and serve God. He was saying, get away from me. I don't want no trouble with y'all. And guess what they did? Guess what they did? They still didn't love their husband, didn't love the wife, didn't pay tithes, didn't. They still kept being disobedient. Here was the enemy. I'm going to read it one more time. And then we'll read verse 32 and then get you out of here. All hats off the live stream. Go ahead, Des. What you got to say? Des, like, she smiled. I went to buy myself my lawyer today. I'm smiling. All hats off. We know you, Des. But it was, I mean, it was so powerful. What you said today probably stuck with me for about 3 hours today. About how Satan reminds you of who you used to be. That was deep. Prepare to teach that on the Bible study soon. You need to really teach that. All right, I'm almost done. Real quick. Chevy in the building, all hats off. And he called Moses and Aaron by night and said, rise up and get forth from among my people. He said, get away from me. See, when you... I can go so many different directions. You know, sometimes when in relationship, we get mad when people leave us and relationships don't work, don't we? Tell the truth, y'all. Tell the truth. Some of y'all can still remember when a man left you or broke your heart or just took advantage of you, can't you? I remember when a woman did that to me multiple times. I've had it happen multiple times. I could tell you all of them right now if you wanted to hear it. But all that rejection was so God can set you up. Look at what it says right here in the Word. Let me show you something. I didn't even show you this verse. He said, rise up and get away from my people, both you and the children of Israel. See, the rejection that you face or the pushing away that you face is so that you can be set up for greatness. He was kicking them out of Egypt so they could be set up to walk as children of God so they can walk in their full destiny. Sometimes that man will kick you out of his bed because he's trying to, God's using him to kick you out of fornication so you can walk into marriage with the man that God has called you to marry. So the only way you could have done that was to be rejected by that knucklehead. That's it. If you're in an abusive, crazy, bad relationship, it's violent, cursing, all that stuff, you got to be like, all right, God, cool. You're kicking me out of Egypt. Thank you. But we get so mad, we get kicked out of anywhere. We don't like it. He's kicking you out of Egypt so you can be successful. I was in a prayer line the other day, right? And I was talking about how this girl cheated on me back in the day. And she was smoking, getting high. It was a church girl, right? I'm like, you ain't no church girl. You smoking, drinking, having sex, doing all this crazy stuff, right? And I was like, but inside it broke my heart. In all reality, it broke my heart. I told her that, right? And for many years, I didn't understand it. Until 2 weeks ago when I said this on the prayer line, West Philly said something crazy. She said, you dodged a bullet. Because you one wrong move and we could have been married, stuck together, baby mama job. You have no clue. She said, yo, you, and I was like, yo, that was hot. She said, you ducked a bullet. But this is what happened right here. They got kicked out of Egypt. Some of us get so frustrated because we've been in bad relationships that we never learn how to recover. God was telling them, listen, I know you've been in slavery. I know it's been crazy. I know it's been bad. But if you play this thing right, we're going to kick you out and you're going to be set up for greatness. Sometimes rejection is the best thing that could have ever happened to you. The best thing. My wife tells, listen, wait till you hear my wife preach on, you're not preaching on Sunday, but maybe when we get back, she's going to preach this thing, boy. She was at home the other day talking about her life, and I'm telling you, it just blew my mind, all out of hurt and rejection. God will bring you the greatest thing that you've ever, ever, ever known. Me. I'm trying to lighten the mood up, y'all. Listen. He called for Moses and Aaron by night and said, rise up and get forth from among my people, both you and the children of Israel. Everybody connected to you, Janilla. Sometimes that man will not want to be with you. Why? Because he knows he's not really meant for you. He's not really good for you. And he wants you to have the best thing that you can have. So don't cry over spilled milk and don't kick the refrigerator down. Go and do what God called you to do. It's okay. Yes, you've been kicked out. That's cool. But you're going to a better place. You're going into the door that God's getting ready to open for you. You know what I'm saying? The door is getting ready to open. It's opening. It's like, oh my God, the door is open. The door of slavery would have never opened for them had they not been kicked out. It says right here, it says, take your flock, take your herd, take everything and get the heck away from us. Because you've got the power of God. When the power of God's on your life, the enemy doesn't want to be anywhere around you. That's why the devil is so comfortable around Christians, because they don't walk with the power of God. So he ain't afraid to be next to some of us. He's like, you ain't got no power. When you got power, you'll be kicked out of places. You'll be fired from jobs. You'll be left for dead. You'll be kicked out of your house. You'll be cursed at, laughed at, scorned. You'll go through all that stuff because you're walking with the, because you have the potential to walk with the power of God. Let me say that. You have the potential, though. Just the potential alone will have you getting kicked out and rejected. Just the potential alone, Des. You don't even have to fulfill. I'm not telling you not to fulfill your potential. What I'm saying is God is showing you that just the, when the enemy recognizes your potential, he doesn't want to be around you. That's why you see people that want a one-night stand, because they know that they can't be close to you that long, because they know their whole life will change. They don't want that. Let them go. That's why T.D. Jakes said, lose them and let them go. That's the best, some of the best things you could ever do. This is all about tithing, presenting everything you have to God. So when I present it to God, now I've got divine ability. The Israelites did not know that they had such ability. Pharaoh recognized it on them. They didn't even know they had it. Some of y'all don't even know how beautiful you are because you're judging it by a mirror or a scale. You don't even know. Some of us don't even know how healthy and strong we are because we're judging it by report. We don't even know how great our marriage could be because we're judging it by bills and rules and regulations and requirements. We don't even know what God has for us. The children of Israel did not even know they had this power. Pharaoh had to recognize it on them. Y'all quiet. Don't let the enemy come and tell you how great you are. You gotta know it. God, I'm tired. I'm worn out. I can't do it. I can't quit. And then the enemy comes up and says, but you said you was gonna pray all night. Please. Like Martin, please. Listen, don't let the Pharaoh of your life come and speak over you. If he does, you're this close to being washed up. When Pharaoh comes and tells you, Exodus chapter 12, go home and read it for you. Just read 12, 31. What do we read? 31 and what? Read those 5 or 6 verses. And imagine yourself being the person that Pharaoh is speaking over and telling you to get out because you got too much power. You have too much power. That's why they have. And this is also why the enemy wants to be close to you, because they want to control you so you don't use your power or exercise your power. This is why. He recognized the power that he has in you. And sometimes the only way we can recognize that is to be stripped of everything that we have. The time that I knew that I was going to truly preach was when I lost my job. That's when I knew that it was on. I said, I didn't get it. I didn't get it right away because I told you I was driving home. I was crying. I was like this. I was driving a pickup truck and I sat in front of my car and my wife was coming out the house with a brand new little baby and I was sitting in the car. I was like 4 cars down and I had tears coming down my eyes. I was on the phone with Mr. Foreman. I was driving a gray Chevy sarcoma, and I was sitting in there, and I was just crying in the car, crying in the car, crying in the car, and I was like, oh my God, I'm not going to be able to feed my family. God, how am I going to do it? I'm going to be in foreclosure. I'm going to lose everything. I'm going to have no money. My wife's going to leave. The kids going to leave. We're going to be in a shelter. Something crazy is going to happen, and that's what God spoke to me. Tears, everything. That's what God was like. He knew somebody that was not saved. Called me up and said, Mike, I will never let you be broke. Not saved. Not in church. They probably ain't been in church one or two times the past 10 years. Called me up and said that to me. The Pharaoh of your life is speaking to each and every one of you sometimes. Saying, why are we not more loving? You said you would. Any questions? This could be a tough subject, but any questions? Comments, questions, comments, something. Say something. Say something. Something. For something, right? Amen. All hands off to something. Faith. Any questions on live stream? Pharaoh said to the people, you said that you would serve God. Go do as you said you would. God didn't say it. Moses didn't. For one time, the leaders didn't say it. For one time. For one time, Jezebel came up and said to you, Regina, do what you said.
Not when you have to walk, because you know a lot of people walk on Sundays, so, you know, that got nothing to do when you're not in the building. But not having a job, like not, you know, being at a job, but you just made a commitment and join the church, but you never really come. You said it, you're going to be a member of that church. And it was so amazing because she had showed me some on her page about the, you know, that church, about the, you know, the lady or whoever the person was, she was missing on her giving. So they sent her an invoice of a bill, like, you know, like the area where she was missing. Yeah, it was just so crazy, but, like, when I saw her, I laughed and I said, wow, this is insane, how, you know, people, that, but it's just pretty much like, you go and take a commitment to an area where you're not, you didn't keep your word. Like, it's just, it was just so, it just reminded me there, like how, like, you know, many times we take commitment to an area, but we never pretty much keep that one. We just like, okay, I'm going to do this, but we don't do it. Or we barely attend to the church, or we barely attend to making sure that, you know, just like when I say, a couple weeks ago when I was speaking, how, you know, we take a position in the building, but we don't keep that commitment. Like, and sometimes it really got to remind us, like, hey, you say this. But we'll be the first one saying, like, oh, it's not organized, it's not this church is not organized, this thing is so dysfunctional. Like, you know, but the thing is, you were the one, the people was a part of that, too, but you didn't keep the word. So when one person just fall down and you didn't keep it, what do you think it was? Like, it just took me there, like, especially when I saw that lady involved, I think that was very, you know, interesting. While the church was sent her there, but on top of that, like, it was amazing. We don't know what commitment she took with the church.
That's right.
Yeah. Like, you know, really, you have no idea, like, okay, like, you know, many places, like, if I take a commitment, like, if, just like when I went to the doctor the other day, I signed up, you signed up to pay for your copay. So, but when the thing happened to me, I didn't have my referral. The first thing they made me sign, it was I forgot what it was, a paper showing like you are responsible for this bill. You don't bring that referral, you're gonna pay that $250 gonna come in the mail, and because you signed the paper saying, okay, go ahead, do the procedure, but I'm still gonna pay, like I'm responsible for this bill. Now when the bill comes now, I'm not paying this. You signed the paper. You signed the bill, it's just as simple when you sign the credit card. You signed that credit card like when you're the boss sign, like you signed the paper saying that you're gonna pay for that. So you borrow money from a company, and you sign and say, hey, thank you for letting me borrow $5,000. I have to pay that $5,000 back. But when the bill comes, we're like, I don't have the money right now. You said it says on it, are you agreeing for this? And you know, they always say you're agreeing for this term and blah, 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 before you sign it. Yes, she said when you put an upgrade on your phone with Apple, they always say, are you agreeing for this term?
That's right.
And guess what? Whatever's going to come on that, the new set, Apple sending to your phone, that's on you. You can't go back.
True.
You cannot go back. Because once you sign that thing on your thing and say, yeah, I agree, like today when I was up my iPad, it says, are you agreeing for this new, you know, setting?
Who paying for that?
And all that stuff. I mean, it's free, but you are agreeing for everything you are changing. So when you go there, like the new apps, like some of the apps, I'm like, I regret it when I did it. Because I was so mad, it made me lose all my music from the internet. I'm like, why did I sign up? Like, I agree for to this thing. I was so mad because for the past 2 Sundays, I cannot get my music together.
Isn't that how we get with God sometimes? Why did I say I was going to love you, God, and serve you, God? Right? But in all reality, like you said, once that commitment is there, the prayer changes. All right, God, help me keep my commitment. Help
That's
me find a way
praying.
To do the best. Yeah,
yeah.
Like your prayer changes.
With
your
my unbelief, help me, God. Help me in every area. Like, what if, like, I say I was going to do this, but help me to continue to press through it. Maybe I might have to do, like, this step to get the way I need to get, but I'm not going to give up because he remained the same. His word didn't change. The same way he promised to the children of Israel that he's going to bring them out, he kept his word. So we never keep our word. We say one thing, God, I promise I'm going to be faithful to you. God, I promise I'm going to do this and this and that. I promise I'm going to be at my job. When you sound like, are you going to be at your job every day at this time, they're expecting you, yeah, I'm going to be the perfect employee. So you pass that, don't have, God forbid your job has a union. Soon your job have union. Oh, now please. I go to my job today, workers are sitting there like sleeping at your job. I mean knocked out. Sleep like the other one is on his iPad, like the other one's so loud on the phone. I was like, they're having it because guess what? They're all covered by the union. So whatever they're gonna do, they can find it because they're paying the dues every month. That's what you said. You say you're gonna keep this company, but you're sleeping at your job. You say you joining this church, but you let the water coming down the building and nobody's there to fix it. You're not there to help to keep this light on. You said that you're going to be a member of the church. It's just the same way, you know, all those commitments we make, like, when they get my son's scholarship. Do you want to accept this fee, like, there's going to be $100 you're going to pay us? Please sign it and return it back to us. They didn't give it to me until I signed that day. So whatever commitment we make, we gotta make sure we can. Because God is giving His covenant with us. Why we can't?
And the biggest thing, Stacey, were you gonna say something?
Mm-hmm. Yes. I just started to look.
All right. Don't put me on the spot, Pat. remember, don't make the enemy look good. Don't make the enemy look good. He's already saying negative and nasty, mean things about us. We can't make him look good by not keeping our word. You know what I'm saying? And when in the book of Exodus, now remember this. Please remember this. When we talk about tithing, that's why tithing is such a higher aspect than just money. All Pharaoh knew was that they had power of God, and that they kept their word, God was going to honor His word with them. Tithing is about everything that I own, I'm going to present it back to you, God. And people will begin to recognize it. Go ahead, Aisha B.
Well, just thinking about what Pastor Marion was saying, one of the things we don't do with God is God has given us small print to say, you know, obedience, to do the things that He asked us to do. So when we make the promises, we forget about His small print to say, yes, we promise to do this for you. But there are all the things we're supposed to do, and how many of us are actually doing it? We're making that agreement, but we're not following the small print. When you go to sign some of these papers, they got the small print that everybody is missing. And God is telling us, you need to go back and read my word for my small print.
It was amazing when you said that. When we were at the old building, I can't remember what scripture God gave me, but it was about reading the fine print. And there's something called a title loan. Anybody know what a title loan is? Yeah, that's people laughing. Like, I did one. But a title loan, if you don't know, is you sign the title of your car over to a person. They give you money, and then they charge you. They can charge you 36% interest per day, maximum 360% per month. So if you borrow $1,000, you owe them $4,600 and whatever. You know, I mean, it's designed for you to pay it back like in the next day or so. It's not designed for you to pay it back over a month or anything like that. And then when you don't do that, of course, they come and take the car. But it's about the fine print. So I had this lady come in my office one day. I don't know how I met this lady, but somebody was like, yo, go to Mike, he'll fix everything. So she comes to me, and I'm like, title loan, what you want me to do with this? You want to give me your car? I don't know, like, what's up? And she's like, nah. And I'll never forget this. She was pregnant. She had all these tattoos. Her boyfriend had just beat her up. I mean, like, kicked her in the stomach. She just came from the hospital. And I was like, man, I got to help this lady, man. So she was like, I have no, she said, my problem is, I'm getting a job, but the job requires me to have a car. And I got this baby, and I'm moving out. I got nowhere to go, so I got to sleep in my car. So I'm like, oh, my God, like, you can't come sleep with us. So I'm just hoping that ain't what you're asking. But it's a joke, y'all. Y'all too stiff tonight. Loosen up. But what happened was I felt compassion for this lady. So I said, let me call these people up. So I called down there, and they're like, no, she owes this amount of money, da, 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 da. They were like, no, listen, we're not giving her a car. Her car belongs to us. And so I was like, oh, my God, what am I going to do? What am I going to do? So I stopped. I said, you know what? I said, man, hold on. Just give me a second. I went in the office, and I prayed. I said, Father, in the name of Jesus, give me some kind of word to say. I called them back, and I was like, look, I'm writing you a letter right now. And I was like, I'm telling you, in the name of Jesus, you're going to release this lady's car. And he was like, all right, yeah, whatever. Click. Boom. I said, all right, they really going to get me hyped now. Now I'm ready to go to Delaware. So now I said, you know what? God said, no, put it in writing. So I wrote it all up. I went on the internet, cited all these laws, all these different things. And I was like, listen, I said, she found your advertisement in Pennsylvania, and you were down in Delaware. That's a violation of this code, da, 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 da. So I sent it down to him, boom. Manager read that joint. He called me right back like, yeah, all right, cool. Well, this is what you do. Tell her to bring her $200, and she can have her car right now. I mean, he dropped like $4,000 worth of fees. But in the middle of that little crisis, I was like, what can I do? Pregnant lady, just got beat up, going to be living in the street with her other two kids, got a job. Now she's really going to be homeless because she can't get the job because she don't got no car. And God was like, slow down. Just pray. And when he started giving me the stuff to do, then I began to think like, all right, cool, I can do this, can do that, do this, do that. And when I sent it back, the dude was like, look, he called me back after. He was like, yo, he was like, seriously, like, you're not going to call anybody on this, right? And I said, no, it's all good. Listen, no snitching. You do what you say you're going to do. I'll keep my word. We're all good. And God is saying the same thing. If you just keep your word, it's all gravy, baby. All gravy. Just keep your word. Pharaoh. Jezebel. Don't let them, listen, y'all wives, I'm going to stop, remember I did this the other, y'all wives, husbands out there, people looking at our live stream, seriously, living on live stream, we can't let Magic Mike teach a husband how to take care of a wife. You can't let Jezebel teach a wife how to take care of a husband. This is what it's talking about in the book of Exodus. You can apply this word to any part of your life. Any part of your life. If you got a hole or a chink in your armor, apply Exodus 12, 28 through 31. Amen. Any other questions? Comments? Des, I know you always got something to say. Des, I always rely on you for something.
I mean, yes.
Not right there. Nicole Lex? Janina with a J! It's such a pleasure to see you. You always got someone's life. Girl, you gonna sing the song tonight? Lord, can you hear me? Can you hear me? I'm going after you.
I'm working on a new one.
You're going on a new one? Amen. But do you have any comments, questions, anything? No?
I got a testimony.
Yeah, testimony. Okay, hold on. We're going to save you a testimony because I know something good. And if you want $1 million, let the brother hook the brother up outside. You know, I want everybody to see what we got. Go ahead, Des.
I just, a comment saying I appreciate the kick out.
Whoa, come on. You better preach that. Yeah.
So I gave you something.
Amen.
Is that what you're relying on?
Yeah, come on.
You know, I mean, you know, I can write 50 books, but I just appreciate the kick out. Like, so many times, even down to my kids recently. Even though I had that transferring process, you know, they kicked us out.
Who? Parkland?
Yeah, no.
Delta. Oh, you preaching good.
It was like, and I'm sitting there in the meeting like, you don't even know.
You don't even know.
But it was just the fact that I had it in progress. And they sat here and put us out, like literally. It was like, you put the good guys out, and I just had to really just explain to my kids, and they finally got it, like, wow, people really intentionally try to, you know, they come after you, they plot against you. They didn't really understand the plot, and people actually are jealous, and they don't like you. I said, the power, yeah, just being kicked out. I mean, even down to my son, like, this is not the first time that my kids have been kicked out of school for something that they haven't done.
Amen.
Like, even with my son now, that would be like maybe a prayer request on finding somewhere. Like, they start so young with putting them down. Yeah. Like, I mean, for, you know, kind of a quick story, but so, I mean, a lot of people don't really know PJ here. He's very either shy and reserved or either he's very hyper. But so I went to get him a kindergarten assessment at Holy Cross, and of course initially he's very shy and reserved. So the lady comes and she takes his hand to go take him in the hall, and I was like, well, do you mind if I come? You know, he's not going to go with you. He doesn't know you. And she said, no, you're not going to kindergarten with him. Okay, but we are here for you to just know what he knows to see if he can get in here. But I mean, she was so adamant, and anyway, I kind of stood outside the door and I was like, PJ, remember what I told you? Answer this lady questions. Da, da, da. So he gets in there, and of course he did horribly. He crying. She comes back out, and she was like, "I don't know what you want me to do." So instead of maybe giving me some suggestions or coming out and saying, "You know what? Could you sit across the room? Could you do this?" But you instantly kicked him out. You kicked him out before he even got in. No, but I mean that was just the whole moment, like. You didn't even allow him to come in. You didn't even come out and say, well, what can we do to calm him down for him to, you know, get through the assessment? And, you know, I fought for a retrial. Like, you're not going to just put him out. You didn't even get a chance to know. So I called back, and I was like, talked to somebody, and I was like, well, listen, is this how it goes here? This is not the first school that I've gotten an assessment at. This is actually the third or fourth. And everybody else was cool with, you know, somebody coming in. But it was so funny because this is the first time that I was at the assessment. Mm. And the other time, my husband took him. They didn't even mind. Oh, come on, Dad. You know, yeah, Jezebel. You want, he needs assistance. You know, any other time. He went to 4 schools. The moment I went for the assessment, they kicked him out. I mean, he didn't even get in. But, you know, I fought for it to get reassessed. And when he came back, you know, he did everything. I sat in class, and I said he answered everything. The room probably this big. Say I'm in the corner, he over there. Like, he just maybe turned around a few times just to check to see if I was there for his comfortability level. But he answered every question. Her response was, oh, he did fair. I was like, what the blood? Like, really? But then, you know, what happened then next week was I get the letter from Children's Scholarship saying that you got $2,100. To go wherever. Now, oh, he ready to come here?
Yeah.
He ready?
That's in 4 years.
He ready? So I just was like,
that's in 4 years.
I just appreciate the kick out because God showed me that maybe this ain't the place for me.
Yeah.
Even though I had all my eggs in one basket, we kind of like this place, but I just had moments of being kicked out of plenty of places, and I appreciate it because it gets me to the next level.
Hey, we're in Bible study, sir. Can I call you back, please? Okay, yeah, check on live stream. We're on it.
All right.
Thank you, sir. So as you were talking,
I appreciate the kick out.
You gave me part two. I'm gonna use Drake's song, Thank Me Later. Thank you. Yes. That was tremendously powerful.
It was really, just the whole moment of them really putting my kids out of school recently. Yes. And it was like, you don't even know what I got in school. You thought you was hurting us. Like, you was giving us a bad record and you know, you was going to have an expulsion on their record.
So glad you registered that before. And all stuff.
It was like, yes.
It's nothing for God because, you know, you couldn't take that someone else who was in school under our arm and get that bad record.
Yes.
But also remember this, that though, the test is not for them, it's for us. Remember, see, most people recognize the power
it's
on you.
Strength. You can't appreciate anything. I told my kids that, like, you're striving for greatness, and we're not maybe people that are content with mediocrity. So in order to get there, you have to be able to go through all these punches and wounds and kicks and all these things in order to be able to sustain it. Because not even success in the monetary status, just with whatever you want to be able to become. If you want to become something great, you have to go through all these things because you won't be able to get there. Or you won't be able to appreciate it either.
Yeah, because if it's God,
if somebody gave it to you, you won't be able to
walk through it.
So you got to fight for it because when you get there, you won't appreciate it.
You pull up, you're like deep thought. I see your pale eyebrows like twisting. Like this. Amen. Janilla, come on up and tell us, or you can sit down and tell us your testimony before we close.
It was funny because some of the things that you said just now kind of coincided with my testimony. As far as like being like the cherry on top of your wrist, then, and are you gonna pull out the God and actually believe and leave in his hands? So what had happened was, Thursday, isn't it? No, Monday morning. All right, I was supposed to take this test to finalize my hair license because I was on a temporary one. So my job was in jeopardy because the lady, it expired. And she was like, we need your license, you can't work. And I'm like, okay. So I went in the first time to go take my test. I failed because I didn't study and I thought, oh, I got this. And I failed by 1 point. So I'm like, I had to reschedule, but you got paid for it every time. So I was like, I don't have $100 to give away here and there. So I paid for it. And then scheduled it for Monday. So I did the overnight on Sunday. So I got home 7 in the morning and I had no recollections of leaving my lights on in the car. None whatsoever. It's daytime. I didn't have to leave my lights on, so I don't remember turning them on. So as an hour went past, I'm getting ready, to go to take the test or whatever. My neighbor's banging on the window saying, your lights are on. I'm like, oh my God, it's been almost an hour and a half. I know my car is dead. Mm-hmm. So I went out there, the car was dead. Mm-hmm. So initially I started freaking out and I'm like, cause that was the cherry on top. I'm like, you know what? I'm about to give up, forget this mm-hmm. job, forget everything. I don't care. So then I kind of just stood there for a minute. I went to the bathroom and I started praying and I even stomped my foot. Everything. And I was praying, so you know what? I'm not going to give up. It's not over. Mind you, I had to be out 20 minutes ago because I had to go all the way to Plymouth meeting somewhere. It was a 40-minute drive. So I called the babysitter and I'm like, listen, I don't know if you can help me, but my car is dead. Can you give me a jump? She was like, girl, I don't know because I'm supposed to leave out of it. But basically, her whole demeanor was she's not going to help me. So I just sat out in the car. I didn't know what I was waiting for. I'm like, somebody's going to help me. And I just sat there waiting in the car. And the babysitter pulled up 15 minutes later. She's like, come on, let's go. And I couldn't believe it. I'm like, oh my God. And then she jumped the car and I made it to the test 5 minutes before it was the thing where you can't take it no more if you're late.
Come on.
And I passed.
Somebody's going to help me in Jesus' name.
I did. I sat in the car. I didn't know who was going to help me, but I sat there. I had my hood up. I'm like, somebody's going to help me. And she pulled up. And when she pulled up, I was like, oh my gosh. Thank you, Lord.
Yeah. And that's not life or death. But for you, a license, and that's your life. That's life or death. You know what I mean? That's life or death. And that's a crisis. And then in the middle of the crisis, you did what you were supposed to do. So you passed that test.
This close.
This close.
I've been watching these.
Come on, this close. That's good.
They're interesting.
That's good. That's awesome.
So it may not sound like much.
That's tremendous. It's tremendous.
Yeah.
Believe me.
Everybody don't get their license.
And just the fact that the person who you counted on, God turned their heart.
No, then something she said was like, the devil reminds me of who I used to be, because the old me would have just gave up.
Yep.
I wouldn't call nobody or nothing. I would just like let it go.
Forget it.
But then I said, the new me put my pride to the side, and I had my faith, and I said, somebody's going to help me.
The fact that you said, forget it, those are the... That's deep.
Yeah.
That's deep.
That was an epic moment.
That is a problem.
Yeah, that is. That's right. That's life change. That's a change-making moment in your life. I mean, guess what? You know, I think we just said it earlier today, like in the middle of a crisis, who do you call on? You know what I mean? Like even for small things, you can't find your keys to your car. How frustrating is that? When you can't find your keys to your car, you know you got 1 minute to get out the house, and you're like, where my keys at? And you're the only one that had them. Right?
Blame the kids.
Right, blame the kids, right? It's always the kids' fault. They don't drive, ain't got no license, but why didn't get your keys? All right. Father, we thank you. Father, we bless you. Father, we glorify your name today, God. We thank you, Father, that we will hide these words in our heart. We thank you for your word in the book of Exodus chapter 12, God, that we will recognize who we are, God, with the power that we represent in the name of Jesus. Father, we thank you, Lord God, that you have given us a guide on how to get a prayer answered in the name of Jesus. We thank you, Father, that we would celebrate it before we see it. We thank you that we would walk in faith and not doubt. We thank you, Father God, that we would be a caretaker of the word. We thank you, Father God, that we would honor the vessel. We thank you, Father, that we would present the word back to you, God, in the name of Jesus. And we thank you, Father, for the prophetic deliverance of your word in Jesus' name. We thank you, Father, for all these things that our obedience shall launch us into a great destiny. Our obedience shall give us divine ability. Our obedience shall loose the power of God upon our lives, that people may recognize who we are. In Jesus' name, amen. Good night.
All right, Stacy, what you got?
I'll sit the basket up here. Des, thank you for a soon-to-be sermon. Go ahead.
Late bloomer.
Come on.
I'm focused though. I'm correct.
All right.